into, let's see, this is October, it'll be my third month. So, a long tenure in the role. In person, the dedication of the George C. Fosgate Black Box Theater. George Fosgate, as many of you know, was a founding member of the theater faculty at the University of Minnesota Morris. And in multiple ways, and quite literally, this stage is his. Before his retirement acting career, George directed about 70 plays and musicals at Morris between 1963 and 1995. And he created, directed, and performed in the campus's summer theater program. He was instrumental in the formation of Mitigans, a campus student theater group, and particularly appropriate to the naming of this theater in his honor, George served on the Humanities Fine Arts Building Design Committee. One of the things that I most love about Morris is its cross-campus connections. George also served as faculty representative for Cougar Athletics and was inducted in the Cougar Hall of Fame with the 1970 football and baseball teams. To make sure that others could pursue the joys of a liberal arts theater degree, George established the Fosgate Theater Scholarship, which provides support to students pursuing a degree in theater arts here. And here, I would argue, at a public liberal arts college, is an excellent place to pursue the valuable knowledge and skills of a theater major. For all of these reasons and many more, I will relish being in and referring to the Fosgate Black Box Theater. Thank you, George, for being part of the University of Minnesota Morris community and for all you have done for us, and thank you all for joining us here today for this dedication.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ray Schultz. I'm one of the three theater faculty here at the University of Minnesota Morris. And to inaugurate the George C. Fosgate Black Box Theater, today we'd like to pay tribute to George's long and illustrious career at Morris by taking just a few minutes to recreate some of his more iconic pieces from the dozens, as Jack was just saying, of plays that he has directed over the years. In preparation for this event, we have our archive, and I was looking at all of the titles over the years that George has directed. And the word I kept coming back to was eclectic. And if you were watching and listening to the amazing slideshow that my colleague Luke Granholm put together for the pre-show, you would know exactly what I mean. The range of material he has tackled over his years here with our students is simply astonishing. From Plautus to Shakespeare, from Oscar Wilde to Rodgers and Hammerstein, from Harold Pinter to William Inge and Wendy Wasserstein, just to name a few, George covered pretty much every genre of dramatic literature from every period of theater history. And so obviously today, we can only scratch the surface, so we're only gonna do a few short pieces. And it's exciting to see so many people here. And I think it's a testament to George's influence on so many generations of UMM students that there are many people who can't be here tonight just simply because they're working in the theater. But we do have some alums here today and some current students, and a surprise guest later on up our sleeve. But to get things off to a bang, I'd like to introduce Barb Roy, class of 71, who's going to introduce and perform in our first selection. Barb?
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Do you remember us from long, long ago? It's me, Edna, from A Delicate Balance.
And me, Buddy Baker, from Come Blow Your Horn.
And Miss Minnie from The Secret Life of Walter Mitty.
Hysteria from A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum.
Prince Dauntless the Dread from Once Upon a Mansion.
Charlie Brown.
The Nathmas too.
What would be down outrageous?
And from Celebration,
a sycophant.
And Potemkin.
And
somewhere here, Edgar Allan Rich.
It's so great,
it's so great to see you.
We're going to do a little bit from a show you directed in 1968 called Viet Rock.
You probably remember that most of us were not even in Viet Rock.
Just one of us was.
Viet Rock was unusual.
It was edgy.
It was political.
It was a new kind of theater called transformational theater, where the actors became different characters in different places without warning.
The actors might transform from war protesters to U.S. senators, just like that. It really was an entirely new way to structure and perform theater.
And it was written by a woman.
Oh. George, here's some of what you said about Viet Rock in the program's director's note.
Quote, why Viet Rock? Because it's what's happening.
It's not just that it deals with contemporary content, the war and all the disparate and ambivalent feelings and opinions evoked there.
It is new in its style of presentation.
This is not a play to be read in the classroom.
This is a play to be experienced.
As an educational theater group, we are concerned that our students be allowed to discover firsthand
through performance
what is happening in the theater now, unquote.
Now, very much abridged, we bring you
Viet Rock!
Far across the southern sea, the land where Viet Rock. Here every morning you can see the Viet's roll. When the bombs fall, the Viet's rock and rock. When napalm bursts, then the Viet's roll. Rock and roll, rock and roll. How the sweet Viet's love to rock and roll. Do the Viet rock, what that Viet roll. Do the Viet rock, watch that Viet roll. Rock and roll, rock and roll. Do the Viet rock.
Things could be different.
Nobody wins.
What you don't know can kill you.
Soldiers, line up.
Jump, cough, bend. Stick him in the arm, stick him in the end. U.S. government infected male. Jump, cough, bend. Stick him in the arm, stick him in the end. U.S. government infected male.
All right, girlies, you're in the army now. You're not a top cow.
Stop the war in Vietnam.
Hey, Sarge, look at all the lovely ladies. You come to see me on.
Hey, that's a protester, you dog boy, piss-headed laddie.
Make love, not war.
Stop this merciless war. Citizens arrest.
You can't arrest us. The army is the instrument of the will of the people, mushheads. Go back to U.S. History 101. Have you forgotten the Indian Wars?
Stop this war.
We didn't start it.
Innocent people are being maimed.
Sorry about that.
And murdered!
Downright sorry about
must serve. It's just because you don't
agree with your country
doesn't mean you shouldn't
do what they tell you to.
Let the meeting of the Senate Investigating Committee begin. I will make my opening remarks brief. The situation is grave. We hope with the aid of the Almighty to find a just, equitable, and profitable solution. I call the first witness. Sir, the people of America are very pleased to have a person of your caliber and career come forward and express his views on our position in
Vietnam.
I see it as my duty, Senator.
May we hear your views, sir?
Yes, sir. It's time, I believe, that we stop pussyfooting around and win that war. I say we lay our cards on the line and do the job. I say get the atomic bulldozer operational. Push that jungle into the sea.
Well thought out.
Somebody had to do it.
Next witness.
I am the greatest. The greatest and the prettiest and the sweetest that you will ever see.
What is your position on our position in Vietnam?
To a neutral corner, you should retire. Before all our pretty boys and cute tiny friends expire.
Next witness.
If the ignorant and sensational press would just stop overreacting, we could get the job done, but no. Every tiny mistake, a few teensy bundles of bombs dropped, and the ignorant and sensational press just has to blow everything up. Blow it up, blow it up, blow
yes,
it up.
Witness! Sir, it is indeed an honor to have a writer of your intense commitment to take time off from his typewriter to give his views. What do you think we should do about the war?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing. The war will die of cancer. Everybody will die of cancer. Me, I think too much. I will die of cerebral hemorrhage.
Oh, witness.
Bless you. Bless you. Bless you.
What is your statement, sir?
Love, brother.
Did you say love?
Love, sister. Love. Love. Love or perish. What is this soft-headed, lily-livered kind of thinking? Is this for patriots? Love can't stop tyrants. The flag of the USA shall shelter all who request our aid. There is still something worth fighting and dying for. Freedom! Let freedom ring! Kill for freedom!
Kill for freedom! Hi ho, it's off to war we go. To Vietnam to fight and bomb, hi ho! I hope, hooray, hooray, for the good old USA. We're here to fight for peace and right the Democratic way. Hey!
Moving right along for our next excerpt, I would like to call to the stage some of our current students, ladies.
Good afternoon, I'm Emily Schenes, class of 2022.
And I'm Gina Boss, class of 2023.
And we are current members of the Mind Games Executive Board.
Woo! I am last year's recipient of the scholarship endowed by the man who we are honoring today. Thank you, George. I plan to continue George's legacy of instilling the dedication to, enjoyment of, and the passion for theater in the lives of others. And I want to do that by pursuing a career in secondary education. So thank you, George, for the opportunity to do that. And Emily and I will be performing an excerpt from J.M. Barrie's Peter Pan.
Peter Pan was directed by George for the Presidium Theater during the 1974-75 academic year. It was among the first productions to be performed in the newly built HFA building that we're performing in today. It also employed the famous flying by Foy technology used in the legendary Mary Martin musical version of the play.
Boy, why are you crying?
What is your name?
My name is Wendy Moira Angela Darling. What is yours?
Peter Pan.
Is that all?
Yes.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Doesn't matter.
Where do you live?
Second star to the right and straight on till morning.
That's a funny address.
No, it isn't.
I mean, is that where they send the letters?
Don't get any letters.
But your mother gets letters.
Don't have a mother.
Oh, Peter!
You mustn't touch me.
Why?
No one must ever touch me.
Why?
I don't know.
No wonder you were crying.
I wasn't crying. But I can't get my shadow to stick back on.
Oh my, it has fallen off. How awful. Oh, Peter, you've been trying to stick it on with soap.
Well then?
It must be sewn on.
What is sewn?
You are dreadfully ignorant.
No, I'm not.
I sew it on for you, my little man. Sit here. I dare say it might hurt a little.
I never cry.
And there.
Well, it isn't quite itself yet.
Perhaps I should have ironed it?
Oh, Wendy, look! Look! It's back! Oh, God! Oh, the cleverest of me!
You conceited boy! Of course, I did nothing.
You did a little.
A little? Well, if I'm of no use, then I can at least withdraw.
Oh, Wendy, don't withdraw. Oh, I can't help crowing, Wendy, when I'm pleased with myself. Wendy, one girl is worth more than 20 boys.
You really think so, Peter?
Yes, I do.
Well, I think that's very lovely of you, and I shall get up again. Now, Peter, why did you come to our nursery with us?
To try to hear stories. None of us knows any stories.
How perfectly awful.
Wendy, your mother was telling such a lovely story.
What story was that?
About the prince, and he couldn't find the lady with the glass slipper.
That was Cinderella. He found her, Peter, and they lived happily ever after.
I'm glad.
Wait, where are you going?
To tell the other boy.
Don't go, Peter. I want lots of stories. Oh, the stories that I can tell the boys.
Come on, we'll fly.
Fly? You can fly?
Wendy, come with me.
Oh, dear, I mustn't. Think of Mother, and besides, I can't fly.
I'll teach you.
Oh, how lovely to fly.
I'll teach you how to jump on the wind's back, and away we go. Wendy, when you're sleeping in your silly bed, you could be flying about with me, saying funny things to the stars.
Continue continued to be on my mind all the time in my professional career. I had the great fortune to do Noises Off, that crazy wild show at UMM, and that was done in the Proscenium, but I just will never forget the amazing time that we had. You are a brilliant, brilliant man and an amazing professor, and I'm just so glad that I know you and that I have an opportunity to help honor you in this time. So, coming up here is my rendition of a song from The Fantastics, which I understand you talked it some time ago. This is Much More. Love you, Doc. Congratulations. All the best to you.
Solemn temples, the great globe itself. itself. Yea, all which it inherit shall dissolve, and like this insubstantial pageant fated, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made of, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. And finally, to deliver Prospero's epilogue, I can think of no more fitting person than the man of the hour himself. So, George, will you come on up and bring it home?
Now, my charms are all overthrown, and what strength I have is my own, which is most tank. Now, 'tis true, I must here be confined by you, or sent to Naples. Let me not, since I have my dukedom got, and pardon the deceiver, dwell on this fair island by your spell, but release me from my bands, with the help of your good hands. Gentle breath of yours my sails must fill, or else my project fails, which was to please. Now I want spirits to enforce, art to enchant, and my ending is despair, unless I be relieved by prayer, which pierces so that it assails the mercy itself and frees all faults. As you from crimes would pardon me, let your indulgence set me free.
Space, it seems to me only fitting to be the perfect space to honor his name. Katie Booth, class of 2020. George's scholarship allowed me to study this beloved art form and grow as a person and artist. It allowed me to create
work I am proud of and foster lifelong, cherished relationships with other artists, audience members, and the greater theatrical community. Lucy Lloyd, class of 2011. One of my fondest memories at UMM is spending time with George and Pat as a recipient of their scholarship. They were kind, caring, and genuinely interested in who I was as a person. I'd like to think of you as the definition of a bonus grandfather and a cool theater grandfather. One of our current students, Madison Kessel. I have not had the opportunity to meet George, but I've heard so much about his dedication to the arts and how his impact is still felt throughout the community here at Morris. Because of this, because of his work, the theaters, the students, and even the professors in the department continue to flourish and allow themselves to grow. Margaret Doby, class of 2005. I was honored to receive the George C. Fosgate Scholarship during my time in the theater program at Morris. While this scholarship certainly relieved some financial stress as a student, the impact of George's support for students is not only financial, but also encourages creativity, collaboration, and a career that is very challenging gave me an entryway into it. Alex and Katie Carlson, both were drawn to Morris Theater Program because of the foundation that George helped build, and while there was learning about acting, directing, and stagecraft, we found the most important thing, each other. As the only married couple, so we are told, to have both received the Fosgate Theater Scholarship. Thanks, God. So, it's evident throughout the years that George Fosgate has had a lasting impact on the theater program, but even more so the lives of the students that have passed through these spaces. As a Morris Theater alum and current faculty, I'm looking forward to the ongoing legacy of George's work. Thank you for your long-lasting dedication to the theater program here at Morris. Tony Albright, class of 2011, would also like to read a short little sonnet.
I wouldn't call that a sonnet. Okay. I am class of 2011, Dr. Tony Albright, and I had the opportunity to respond to the email that went out asking for people to talk about how George impacted their lives. George is the only person to ever invest monetarily in me pursuing theater. And so I couldn't help but write something that I hope I can get through now, George. What can be said of the great George Fosgate? Too late to be his student, instead we made friends. And when I needed an ear, he listened. He supported my dreams. He celebrated every time I achieved. And when I grieved, he was there. Keeping my knees connected, we all see what we see in this space that we love. Because George first dreamed dreams. And through scene after scene, believed in the potential of all of us to be or not to be. Whatever we believed we could be. So on this occasion, let us show gratitude for his attitude of charity and his disposition of grace. This space will ever be the place that it is, for graced with his name and laced with his legacy, there is no other thing our black box could ever be.
Class of 1973, and I will not regale you with Mark Anthony's dying oration. Dryden's All for Love or the World Will Lost, that I performed 50 years ago, but I don't think I ever really got through that final speech. I don't think I could do it today. It's a great pleasure for me to be here. It's a privilege to help celebrate the naming of this particular theater. I first met George in the fall of 1969, when as an 18-year-old first student, first-year student at Morris, I enrolled in Introduction to Theater. For the next 4 years, there wasn't a quarter. We were on the quarter system at that time. There wasn't a quarter that went by when I wasn't in one, sometimes two, of George's classes. And during that entire period, I worked on every production that he directed, either as an actor or a technician backstage. The first production I did with George was in the spring of 1970. It was another experimental play like Get Rock by Megan Carey, another woman playwright, called Comings and Goings. And like a lot of first year students, I was doing a lot of different things on campus. That's one of the great joys of Morris. I was on the wrestling team. And there were times when I had to miss rehearsals because we had wrestling meets. And George, appropriately, as a director, was a little annoyed at this behavior. And one day, after rehearsal, he took me aside and he said, "Hanson, you're going to have to make a decision. You know, are you going to major in theater? Are you going to be doing other things, like wrestling?" Well, I wasn't much of a wrestler. The only thing I was doing for the team was raising its GPA. And that made all the difference. That's why I kind of stand before you today as a retired university professor and not a broken down wrestler. The idea for naming the theater has been a long time of mourning. Over 10 years ago, we had a ceremony, a similar ceremony, in the Proscenium Theater to honor Ray Lammers and the naming of the Lammers Theater. And afterwards, there was a reception, and some of the old alumni were standing around, and someone mentioned the idea that wouldn't it be great if the Black Box was named after George? Well, that seed was planted. A few years later, at another homecoming, I started to make some inquiries. And eventually talked to Bill Roth and members of his team and asked if there was a procedure, if there was a process, if there was a donation that had to be made to make this all possible. Bill went and did research. More time passed. He forwarded to me kind of a university process where a formal nomination is written, and then I went out and solicited letters from former students, several of whom are today, who were wonderful testimonials about their time and work with George. That packet of information, that nomination packet, was sent back to Bill. Of course, universities work at a snail's pace. Processes change, administrations change. More time passed, years passed. But eventually, with the help of the theater faculty here and the administration, the proposal was pushed over the line. So that's why we're here today. During this terrible year and a half that we've all been through, one of my highlights occurred in March when we had a Zoom call and informed George that the Black Box Theater was going to be named after him. It was just uplifting experience, and today is the cherry on the sundae to have an actual event and to have George here and his family here and so many students and associates from the years here to celebrate. So I would love to invite my mentor, my teacher, my director, my friend of over 50 years, George Fosgate, up here to say a few remarks. George, please.
Black Box Theater. Well, you've got to story's got to start in 1963. I was here interviewing for the newly created post in theater arts, and Ray Lambers was herding me around the campus, showing me various things and introducing me to various people, and kept reminding me that about 1 o'clock I have an interview with the dean. We didn't have a chancellor then or anything like it. It was the dean, the head honcho. And so, the dean, okay, but I've seen some people, met some people, and all that, and Ray says it's about 5 to 1, it's that time, get ready for your interview with the dean. You need to go to the restroom. I'm thinking, I'm going to an interview with the dean, and yeah. Downstairs in Edson Hall, and so I'm standing here at the urinal. Well, not exactly standing, but this whirlwind whips in the door somehow, hits the stall next to me, and leans over and says, "Hi, I'm Rod Riggs." "Hi, I'm George Fosgate." He says, "Yeah, I know. I'll see you in a while." His hands out the door. He said, "Who's that?" He says, "That's the dean." "That was the dean?" Oh, by the way, when he introduced himself, he didn't offer his hand. And I'm picturing this old gray-haired guy, but no, that was Rod, and what a dynamo he was. So in our interview, he says, "George, in our 10-year plan, we have theaters in our 10-year plan. We have hopefully a whole fine arts complex." And I said, "An experimental school open for 2 years now, and you've got a 10-year plan. But I don't know if we'll both be around to see that, I didn't expect to be here for so long, but right out of grad school, just another step up." So anyway, that was 1963. In the fall of 1973, we moved into this building. And we didn't have any productions in here during the fall because we were busy with the move. In the winter, I had the privilege of directing the first full production in here, and it was in the Black Box. Another transformational thing that I love to do, called The Serpent, a ceremony by Jean-Claude Vanatelli. And a lot of people were a little, never seen anything like Mark. In fact, the kids in it, they didn't know what the hell we were doing. They trusted me, and we did it. We did have occasionally, for Via Rock, we had a few people leave.
Yeah.
But for The Serpent, they stayed. They were kind of puzzled because it went all the way from the Garden of Eden to the Kennedy assassination. In an hour and a half. No intermission. So I just want to thank everybody who had a hand in this honor to bring to me. Bob Hansen for the nomination, of course, and all that shoveling and pushing he had to do. And Ray Schultz gave a wonderful speech in the campus assembly that pushed the vote through right here. Thank you, Ray. All you support writers, my ex-students, and actors in Strange Theater, Bill Rupp and his staff, too, and all the participants in today's program, has been just wonderful. Thanks to all the alumni who joined me in our 32-year journey from no budget to low budget. Thanks. Old colleague Ray Lammers, who'll share the street, I guess, now, thankfully, and Cap Payne, who was the best designer TD I ever worked with. Luke, I've never worked with you, so I don't know. I'm very happy. And lastly, I want to say I'm very happy to have family here. I have my daughter Lori, her husband Mike McGowan, who's UMM grad, by the way, and my sister-in-law Sue Ellen Ross, who's Pat's sister from Seattle, with me today. And last of all, I have to thank my wife Pat, who can't be here with us today, but I'm sure she's here in spirit. She had to put up with a lot for me, but put up without being a lot too. Nights and weekends, and I'm sure she's here in spirit somewhere. And thank you all for being here and being so gracious and putting up with the ticks of an old codger. I look forward to meeting and greeting after this is over. Thank you. Thank you very much.